Hey everybody, this is Eric Rosebrock. I am here in Clearwater, Florida at Ruth Eckerd Hall with John Humphrey, the drummer for Seether, and also a crush artist.
Yes.
Sabian.
Yes.
And Evans Drumheads.
Evans Drumheads, and we're going to give props to Vic Firth Drumsticks.
Yes, Vic Firth.
Been over at Vic Firth.
So you guys have been on tour pretty much most of this year with Seether.
We've been on tour for pretty much the last 12 years.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
I was talking to Dale, it's like you kind of forget timelines and chronologically where things have happened, because it just feels like it's been one tour with it broken up a little bit with a couple trips home and then some albums being recorded in the studio. Otherwise, it's been nonstop. But really, this is the second year for touring for this album cycle for Isolate and Medicate, our last album, our most recent album.
That's an awesome album.
And thank you.
The drumming on that album has really inspired me as well.
Thank you.
You know, it's just some tribal stuff you have going on there. It's just amazing.
Yeah, Words as Weapons, the first single, kind of had definitely that effect to it. I have to give a lot of credit to Brendan O'Brien, our producer. And he's the one, it was kind of a straight-ahead rock song when we first tracked it. Originally, that song was going to be part of a four-song sort of additional EP, the best of, that Seether 2002-2013 sort of greatest hits thing. And we recorded four tracks for it, and one of them was Words as Weapons. But anyway, Brendan had the idea of, like, you know, he had everybody coming to the studio and banging on stuff, man. Stands, music stands, trash cans, drums and stuff. And then he kind of added that into the mix. You know, we had the basic track, and then he pulls up all the sort of that tribal effect that he was like kind of hearing in his head and showing us what he meant. And it just like turned the song into a completely different beast.
That was loud.
And down the drain it went. No.
Down the drain it went.
But anyway, that's totally, you know, credited to Brendan O'Brien and how he, you know, that tribal effect that he kind of gave to the production of the song really took it to a whole nother place. The song turned out so well, we decided to hold it from, you know, that greatest hits and put it on as the first single for Words as Weapons. And it was actually like the first completed song for the album too. So it sort of set the bar for the album. So every song we had to kind of write and add to, we knew that it had to be as good or better that, which was hard to do because we knew we had that in our back pocket and it sounded really good.
Well, I mean, I think the whole Isolate and Medicate album is definitely one of those timeless pieces, man. I mean, I was going through some stuff whenever I found that album in my life, and it, you know, really described a lot of what I was going through, and I appreciate it, so, you know, definitely.
Thanks, man. I mean, that's, you know, music's the same thing for us as well. You know, it's our escape. You know, I've been listening to music since I was a kid, and I go to it when I'm down, I go to it when I'm happy, you know what I mean? Music's just such an important part of my life, has always been. And Shaun's lyrics are that, you know, the listener can identify with it, you know? It's sort of ambiguous enough that, you know, it can apply to your life, you know, the relationships, the troubles that we have, the struggles, the, you know, the inner turmoils, the demons that we all have.
Mm-hmm.
And we're all human. We kind of have that common thread, you know.
Yeah, and that music definitely connects us on that level, so
yeah,
it's great. So the recording process, you know, in modern times where we are right now, where people can work on tracks from home, when you guys put an album like this together, how do you typically collaborate that?
Well, with this, we all went to Los Angeles. Brendan has a studio, a room that he uses at the old A&M studios in Los Angeles, which is now Henson Studios. Historic studio, man. It's been around forever, so many great albums. But he has a room there, and so we all met up in Los Angeles and did the basic tracks. Well, we did everything there. We did the overdubs and everything there in Los Angeles. So we kind of made it old school in that sense, and that's kind of how we've made all the albums up to this point.
Okay.
We kind of put our lives on hold, and then we hole up in whatever city we did. You know, before that, we did Holding On to Strings in Nashville. And we've done overdubs before in New York, but usually, you know, we kind of will live at, you know, an executive apartment like the Oakwoods or something in Los Angeles and kind of live there in an apartment like, you know, old band style, and then head over to the studio and just kind of be focused on the album, the recording and the writing, and just kind of not let the, you know, the phone calls and wives and the normal thing kind of infiltrate into that. We're just kind of like a band and focusing on music for that 2-3 weeks, maybe a month. But this album, we actually recorded it top to bottom in 2.5 weeks. 2.5 weeks, it went really quick, and
wow.
And we knocked it out. It was kind of like a band doing its first album. It went really, really fast, you know. We were rehearsed. The guys came to Oklahoma, where I live, December, just a few weeks before. We went in January 2014 to record Isolate and Medicate. And so in December 2013, my friend has a demo studio in Oklahoma. So the guys came to hang out with me, and we Shaun had already put together 7 or 8 songs. We needed 4 or 5 more to complete the track list. And we worked on songs for 2 or 3 weeks and rehearsed on the others. We were tight and well rehearsed, like we'd been on the road. Went in the studio and knocked it out.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's definitely, it's like I said, a great album.
Thanks, man. Thank you.
Let's talk about gear. What current gear setup? We have Crush drums,
yeah.
Sublime E3 kit.
Yeah, yeah, Sublime series, Maple drums. I know Terry talked to you about some of the mm-hmm. technicalities, and then I'm using the hand-hammered hybrid snare. I put die-cast tubes mm-hmm. on that snare, 7x14. I love that snare, man. It sounds good.
I hit it, by the way.
It's got crack, but it's warm, too. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Some guys prefer wood snares, and this hybrid, that hand, it just sounds great, man. Works great for me.
Definitely.
And a really good live drum, snare drum. And that's kind of it for me, the kit, man. You got to have a good snare to really lock into.
Mm-hmm.
And when you have that, you know, everything will fall into place. But no, it's a great sounding kit, 24-inch kicks. And I'm using a double pedal. I do have a double bass setup, you know,
mm-hmm.
which I play a lot of double bass and implement in my playing, fills and different things. And it was funny, again, Brendan O'Brien, we were talking and we were doing a song for the album called Suffer It All, kind of heavy song, mm-hmm. has a double bass, triplet feel kind of thing. And Brendan's like, man, you need to set up 2 bass drums, man, when you go out live. And we got to talk about Tommy Aldridge. I'm a huge Tommy Aldridge fan.
Yeah.
We were talking about Black Oak, Arkansas, and how he had just that 1 rack tom and 2 giant kick drums, you know. And I'm like,
How many?
So, I added a bass drum to basically my setup, you know, and didn't have to make really any big adjustments to the layout or the feel of it. And it's great, man.
So this tour, I noticed you added a new character to your kit, the pterodactyl looking thing.
Yeah, that thing, that character, I actually painted the Gene Simmons face on it.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, I did the white, you know, I'm a Kiss fan, so it's a little homage to Kiss, you know, Gene Simmons. But I don't know, yeah, somebody threw that up on stage, or I can't remember the story with it, but I painted his face, and then he just became part of my kit. He's been with me for a few years now, several years, in fact.
That's great.
Yeah.
So do you guys have any albums coming up that you're going to foresee working on? You're going to keep going with
Yeah, we have the newest single, Nobody Praying for Me. And
I'm a star that's just a black hole now. I'm a terrifying danger. I'm a freak decaying on the ground. I'm a swallower of anger. I'm the tree that falls and makes no sound.
We're touring that right now. We're 3 Doors right now. We got about 2 weeks left on this tour, and then we go to Europe, overseas, the UK. We're doing Leeds and Reading Fest, big UK festivals, first time for us to do those. And that'll take us all the way through September. I think we'll do another headline, US headline run in October, and possibly South Africa before the year's end. So still a lot of touring, this newest single, and just doing what we do, man. See,
living the dream.
That's it. We're on the road.
So I guess one last question I have for you. What advice do you have for anybody who is coming up in the music scene, trying to get to where you are right now?
Yeah.
Like, I mean, you're doing it. So.
Yeah, don't.
Don't do it. But yeah, like what has made, I guess, like the underground for your success? Like, what's the staple for you?
You know, really, it's hard work, you know. Anybody, if they're getting into this because they think they're going to cheat the system and somehow, you know, they're going to make it rich and famous and not have to put in the hard work that if you did a 9-to-5 job, man. I'm telling you that I've put in more hours, you know, if you added it up to overtime, you know, in a real job, it would be unbelievable. I mean, we've had to work very hard. I mean, I think that has a lot to do with Sean and Dale, originally from South Africa, but I think their background is very similar to mine. I'm from the South, the Midwest, Oklahoma. And my parents, you just were, the work ethic was, you want something out of life, you have to work hard for it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we've always done, man. We've toured relentlessly. We've had success at radio. We've been very fortunate that way, but we've kind of won our fans really one by one, man, just going out there and hitting the road, playing shows, doing good shows, word of mouth, especially in Europe, overseas, you know. And I think you can get anything you want, really. That I know that sounds very sort of generic, like you can attain your dreams, but really I think you work hard. Good things comes, you know, to those that work really hard and put in the time, and I think the work ethic for Seether is, anybody who's looked at our tour schedule for the last 12 years can see that, you know, we work really hard, you know, and you've got to be able to do that. And if you're young and you're starting out, man, play anywhere, play everywhere, you know. My son, he's 16 years old. He just started playing drums about 2.5-3 years ago. Nice. Great little drummer. And I'm like, yeah, I can't believe, you know, I've got this son. He's wanting to get into it, but he's got it. He's a great little player. But I tell him, he plays in our church band. He plays with friends. You know, he just sort of did like the university has this sort of school of rock band camp that they do in the summer. Mm-hmm. He's made friends out of that, and so he's got 2 or 3 different bands he's playing with. So for a young drummer, that's great. One's a cover band. You know, he has to read charts in one. You know, and the other is like original band. So, you know, for an aspiring musician, that's what you just got to play anywhere and everywhere you can, man. You know, you can always learn from musicians. If you play with guys that are, you know, they're at a level that's, you know, been playing longer than yourself, you can always learn from guitar players and bass players, you know, even if they don't play drums. Musicians that are better than yourself help, you know, make yourself better.
Oh,
so,
yeah.
You know, I really encourage working hard and playing anywhere and everywhere you can.
Cool. Well, John, I greatly appreciate this opportunity again.
Thanks, man.
And looking forward to rocking it out there tonight.
Okay.
So I'm excited. So,
thanks, guys.
Hey, Terry, what can you tell me about John's kit?
Well, it's a copper fade. E3. He's playing the hybrid hammered steel snare, hammered brass. Cool thing about Johnny's kit is he's got 2 kick drums, but he only really mics one of them.
Yeah, it's a dummy kit. Secrets out.
When I first saw him, when I went to watch him play the first time, and I was like, oh, you're playing double bass. And he goes, well, really, playing a double bass pedal. I was like, yeah, but it still looks cool.
Oh, yeah, that's cool.
But
so
no.
It's the Sublime E3?
Yeah, this is the E3 kit. Got the reinforced rings on the toms. 8-ply kick. Toms are 6-ply with the re-rings on them. John's using the EC2 Evans heads on them, on the toms. He's got the EMAD system on the kick drum. But yeah, it's 24-inch bass drums, 13-inch racks, 14, 16, and 18-inch floor toms on these. I was playing 3-4 toms on it.
Dude, that feels really good. Like right there, that feels really good, yeah.
Awesome.
The airflow.
In the forest, I'm a lizard with a poison tongue. I'm the child in the manger. I'm the one who sacrificed his son. Rust is showing on my armor. I am wheezing like an old man done. I'm a product of my anger. I'm the bullet in a loaded gun.
Fun yet?
Trying.